My name's Alicia DeCoudreau, and I am the president of Mills College. And it is truly my pleasure to welcome you to Mills tonight as we launch our celebration of Women's History Month. During this month, organizations, academic institutions, and others offer programs and opportunities to increase the consciousness and knowledge of women's history, to remember the contributions of notable, extraordinary, and ordinary women, and to put the accomplishments of women in historical context. At Mills, we do that every month. For the past 160 years, we have committed to cultivating the next generation of thoughtful, powerful women by preparing them to produce positive change in their immediate community and on the larger global landscape. Our students and our alumni make us very proud, and their accomplishments in the arts, the sciences, education, public service, civic engagement, and other fields. We take every opportunity to recognize and celebrate their accomplishments, realizing that recognizing the accomplishments of women has a huge impact on the development of self-respect and better opportunities for girls and young women. We celebrate women during the full spectrum of their life's achievements. Tonight, we are pleased to welcome two extraordinary women who have indeed made an impact in their fields and who are leaders and mentors as well. We are delighted to have with us two veteran observers of politics. I know that we are in store for a fascinating evening with a combination of Linda Wertheimer's deep knowledge of the political process and Christine Pelosi's firm understanding of how leaders are developed. It has been my good fortune to know Linda Wertheimer for nearly 10 years. She's as smart as a whip, has an incredible wit, and is one of the warmest and most gracious women I know. A highly regarded media leader, Linda Wertheimer is known for her discerning analysis and thoughtful reporting on NPR news programs. A graduate of my alma mater, Wellesley College, Linda received a few Wellesley women in the audience. I knew there'd be someone here cheering us on. Linda received Wellesley's Distinguished Alumna Achievement Award in 1985. She is a respected leader in media whose influence on public radio and in the political landscape has been profound. She has been a beloved figure to listeners who have followed her three-decade-long NPR career, most notably her hosting of All Things Considered for 13 years. During her association with that program, the audience grew from 6 million listeners in 1989 to nearly 10 million listeners by spring of 2001, making it one of the top afternoon drive-time news radio programs in the country. Linda has provided highly praised and award-winning coverage of national politics and Congress for NPR, serving as its congressional and then national political correspondent. She has traveled with presidential candidates and regularly reported on major news events, from the Watergate impeachment hearings to the Iran-Contra affair. In 1976, she became the first woman to anchor network coverage of a presidential nomination convention and of election night, and has since anchored 10 presidential nomination conventions and 12 election nights. She is the recipient of journalism awards from the Corporation for Public Broadcasting, American Women in Radio and Television, and the American Legion, among others. Among her numerous accolades, in 1997, she was named one of the top 50 journalists in Washington by Washingtonian Magazine, and in 1998 as one of America's 200 most influential women by Vanity Fair. She is truly an accomplished woman. Linda will talk about the current political climate with special attention on issues faced by the new Congress and our newly reelected president, Barack Obama. Following her talk, she will be joined by Christine Pelosi in what promises to be a very engaged conversation. Ms. Pelosi is also a veteran observer of politics, and they'll discuss challenges unique to women candidates and the expanding role of social media and technology in modern campaigns. We'll have an opportunity for questions from the audience following that conversation. Thank you so much for coming this evening. I hope you'll enjoy our conversation tonight. And I'd ask you to please join me in welcoming a woman I am honored to call my friend, Linda Wertheimer.
Hi there. It's a great pleasure to be here at Mills. This is my first visit to this place. And I have to tell you that when I was trying to figure out where to go to college back in the dawn of time, my mother thought Mills would be a very good place for me to go, because I rather think that she thought it would be more fun to visit Mills than to visit New England. And I disappointed my mother, who never forgave me for it. But I think you know, one of the things about going to the college that I went to is that it would be hard to be any farther away from my hometown of Carlsbad, New Mexico, and still be in the continental United States. So I gained about 1,000 miles by choosing the other coast, and I'm very sorry that I, you know, disappointed my mom, though. Alicia and I know each other from Wellesley, although I certainly wouldn't want you to think that we were in the same class. I had been and gone long before Alicia arrived, but it has been a great pleasure to serve with her, as she was chairman of the Board of Trustees when I became a trustee at Wellesley. And it was a very interesting thing to lift the veil and to see how colleges really do work. And I think that she's got her eye on you now. And how this place really works, it's going to be interesting to see. One of my high school friends came to Mills the same year I went to Wellesley. And so we're trying to find out what she did after that. It will be a great pleasure to have Christine here, and to be able to, you know, I get to ask the first few questions, but at a certain point we'll switch gears so that you guys can talk to either one of us about whatever you want to. I'm very fond of her mother, but of course, as you know, Christine Pelosi is her own self, and famous for her work with campaigning, and we'll talk about that. I think that we're going to talk for the most part tonight about women in politics, which is a subject that I love to talk about. But I just wanted first to mention that I think that we all ought to be paying attention to one of the most interesting political events that is happening right now in Rome. The bishops have not yet decided to go into their conclave, but they are, they're hanging around, they're having meetings, and I assume nice dinners. In Rome, and trying to think about how they want to do this. I suppose that this is one of the most interesting political events to which no girls are invited that still exists. I mean, when you think about it, everything used to be like that. And now there's only this. When I checked the New York Times to be sure that they hadn't gone into the conclave. But they're holding these pre-conclave meetings where what they say they are doing, they've been discussing issues that they're concerned about, child abuse being chief among them, but also the leaks of Vatican documents, which is something they're very concerned about. It's interesting how, this happens at all levels, leaking and being very concerned about leaking. They apparently have had some discussions about how are they going to know that whoever they nominate is going to be as squeaky clean as he can possibly be. And I think history tells us good luck with that. The Archbishop of Chicago, Francis George, made a completely ludicrous on his face statement yesterday, I think, where he said that abuse is practically zero right now, he says. But then he acknowledged that the past remains a problem. Now, I think that, you know, when we think about the progress that, I mean, I suppose there is never going to be, or there is not going to be in my lifetime at any rate, any kind of change in the organization of the church, which would give women any kind of a role in this all-important meeting. But I continue to think that it is one of the most interesting things that happens, the most interesting political events that ever happens. And we at NPR have Sylvia Poggioli and Cokie Roberts there, just to sort of, you know, give them a little bit of something to be thinking about. Now, President Obama, you know, made an extraordinary start at the beginning of his first term when he named Hillary Clinton to be his Secretary of State. That was a, I think that was an extraordinary statement of the kind of leadership that he was hoping to continue to provide, and that women were going to be a part of his campaign as they had been a part of his, I mean, a part of his administration as they had been a part of his campaign. And then the first rattle out of the box, he fell off his pedestal by naming four white guys to some of the biggest jobs that that he has, the Secretaries of State and Defense. There are few people who are whiter than John Kerry, in my opinion. but Chuck Hagel and Jack Lew, who, I mean, I know one could argue with Jack Lew, he's an extraordinarily accomplished person, and his moving his John Brennan into to the CIA is also an interesting thing, because that is, and it is working, the intelligence committees have passed him out, and he's on his way to the floor and will undoubtedly be, after a certain amount of whining by people who were, you know, who were opposed to him but didn't have the votes. And I think, you know, that's moving along. So now the president is trying to get back on top of his pedestal. So today he nominated two women to important jobs, Gina McCarthy to Environmental Protection, and Sylvia Matthews, who's now Sylvia Matthews Burwell, to be director of the budget. So these are apparently, Ms. McCarthy is a reflection of the president's commitment to do something about global warming, so that'll be interesting. And Sylvia Matthews has a long history working with budgets, and she's a very solid and substantial choice of the sort that, you know, that I have always hoped that we would see women coming too. That you no longer, that it's not necessary to be glamorous, it's not necessary to be some kind of a, you know, special person to be the woman who is appointed head of a department, but to be extraordinarily competent and good at what you do. And I think this is a very good appointment. Also in the news is a woman who is looking kind of good for a congressional seat in South Carolina. Elizabeth Colbert Bush, who is related to a fellow who's on television. This is a seat that was vacated by governors. This is a seat that was vacated and by the guy who was appointed to the Senate, and apparently former Governor Mark Sanford has decided that he wants the job too. So he's running. They have a big Republican group running, none of whom are especially, you know, the people are thinking are especially wonderful. Mrs. Bush is going to get the Democratic nomination, as far as I can tell. But Mark Sanford, you know, who's famous for creating the euphemism walking the Appalachian Trail, apparently actually asked his former wife, Jenny Sanford, if she would like to run his campaign. And she told him no. But the best news, it seems to me, for women in politics was this big 2012 campaign itself. Once again, I think women get a lot of credit for the re-election of Barack Obama. When you look at polling, one of the things that we always look at in exit polling is what did men do and what did women do? Because, you know, that just tells you what happened. I mean, it tells you who's won. And what we know is that Mitt Romney won guys. He had about 52% of guys. That's not a big percentage, but he had 52%. Barack Obama had 59% of women. And of course, as we know, there are more women than men in the world and in the voting community as well. So, and then Barack Obama had extraordinary percentages of black women, Latina women, Asian women, and that, I mean, his percentage in the black community was 93%. So, you know, when Mr. Romney carried white people, it was like way not enough. Now it is true, and this is something that, you know, that women and others who are, you know, on the Obama side of the aisle are going to have to spend some time on, and Republicans, if they want to survive, are going to have to spend a lot of time on, and that is turning out black and Hispanic and even Asian voters, but especially black and Hispanic voters. They do not vote in the same numbers as, you know, your basic white people. And so that has to be changed. Now, one of the astonishing things that I just read was that I am a huge fan of 538, the blog in the New York Times, because it is a blog which is full of facts, which I think is unusual in blogs and a very good thing. But something in the order of 500,000 new Hispanic voters will come online in the state of Florida in time for the 2016 election. Now, they're not all Cubans at this point. They're Cubans, Salvadorans, people who are coming up from the sort of the eastern side of the of South America, and they are, I mean, this is, if you look also at the 1 million voters that are coming, that will come online in Texas in that same year. I mean this, you remember that song, I'm Gonna Turn Your Brown Eyes Blue? I mean, there's a possibility exists that some of these red states can turn blue. And I can't imagine that something like this would happen, you know, in 2 years or 4 years, but with some kind of monster efforts to educate and register, it could start happening. You know, we saw it in Colorado, we saw it in Nevada. Arizona is a state that where the Hispanic voters do not vote in the numbers that they should, but if they did, you know, that's another one that could change. We're looking at a whole series of states that used to be swing and are not anymore. It's, you know, it's one of the reasons why the West is not 100% Republican, and it's a very interesting opportunity. Barack Obama, I think, won this election with a superior strategy and a great deal of luck. I mean, he spent a lot of time in the early going bashing Mitt Romney as a rich guy who doesn't care about people like me. And Mr. Romney helped him in every way that he could with that. Car elevators, for goodness sake. Dressage events. And a sort of evaluation of, you know, how much does it cost to take your horse to the Olympics, and you know, with the boots, the hat, all of that, the sort of the invoice for what this hobby of his wife's cost was published. That and the dog on the roof, you know, this was just not a... Haley Barbour, who was the former governor, as you know, of Mississippi, and a really interesting, very funny, mean man, said that that what Barack Obama wanted the American people to do was see Mitt Romney as a wealthy plutocrat married to a known equestrian. And what an amazing thing to say. Now, and you know, he had, I mean, Haley Barbour is his big buddy, as is Chris Christie, who, you know, didn't help him at all. But and Mr. Romney had the very bad luck after having triumphed in the debate, where he looked wonderful, sounded very smart, you know, he's an incredibly handsome guy. And President Obama looked annoyed. You know, why do I have to be here? Why am I doing this? And that was the only bounce at all during the whole election. I mean, if you look at the graphs, they just went right along with this much space between them. And the only, you know, there was a little bit of a dip when you know, going both directions from that debate. In about 3 days, it went away because, you know, this is just one of the sort of the facts of life in politics. Every once in a while, somebody is nominated that the American people do not like. And Mitt Romney, I was one of those people. He was clearly the pick of the litter in the Republican primary season. He has many fine qualities. People who are close to him admire him tremendously. His leadership at Bain Capital and in the Mormon Church and even in his governorship of Massachusetts, people have, you know, spoken very highly of what he did. But he just didn't have that. Somehow he just couldn't relate to people as he ought to have done. Now, the Democrats have done similar things. I mean, Michael Dukakis, not a big hit. John Kerry was not a big hit. But it's just one of those things that, you know, you wonder what the planners and the people who are trying to make things happen are. We'll ask Christine about this. How do you, you know, what do you do when you've got a candidate nobody likes? I'd say run for the exits, but, you know, that's just me. But there's a tremendous amount of progress for women. More than 70 members of the House are women now. Some of them don't have a vote, you know, like the representative from D.C., but it's huge. And 20 in the Senate. So that is, obviously, since there are 100 members of the United States Senate, that's 20%. Will they make a difference? That I think is for me the huge question. I mean, I think that there is a you know, of course, lots of people want to see more women in the legislative bodies because, you know, there should be more women. Half of the world is women. Why shouldn't they be half of the legislative bodies? But when you don't have half, or even if you do have half, what difference does it make? Does it make any kind of difference? Now, Vivian, I don't know if you know about the Souchier Center, which is at the University of Missouri in St. Louis. But Vivian Avaloff, who runs it, it's an institution that helps women campaign, teaches women about how to get into politics, and once they get into office, helps them with governing. And lots of mayors, state legislators and whatnot are sort of come through that process. She says 30%. You got a little more than 30%. You got to have a third. After that, then women, you can really see what they're doing. And I think that may be true. I ask Alicia, from her corporate experience, and she suggests that if you have somewhere in the vicinity of 30%, 25% of a corporate board, you have to have at least three women. but that when you get close to critical mass with that kind of a number, which is really interesting. But what does that mean when you get to critical mass? It seems that, to me, one of the things that it means is that while men, and the I refer you to the House of Representatives, while men seem to enjoy, and I have no idea why, seem to enjoy showing up and having the same argument over and over again, women tend to want to, you know, settle it, fix it, stop doing this, move on to the next thing. Women just don't have time for this kind of stuff. I mean, you think about here at this women's institution, you obviously go to meetings with women and people take assignments and they do things. And that's how, you know, that's how it works, I think, everywhere. But I've been to a lot of meetings where, you know, you're sitting around with a bunch of guys and they start talking and then finally somebody says, "This has been a really good meeting. I'm really glad we had this meeting." And I'm thinking, what did we do? I don't know what we did. It's I think it's gender related, but I'm not sure about that. I'm not sure that anyone has ever really studied it. But whatever women may do, and whatever these additional women may do in the national legislature, I think the great fog of just say no, which is resting on the Capitol at this moment, is probably not really subject either to argument or to persuasion. I mean, there are solutions to this, that things that could stop it. If you wanted to stop it, and obviously there are a lot of people who do not, you know, the 10-year plan would be to eliminate gerrymandering. It would take at least 10 years to eliminate gerrymandering. It probably would take more. There is one fairly fast way to do it, and that is to hold an election. If the American people are really upset, then a replay of 1974 or 1994 would certainly get the attention of members of Congress. As you will not recall because you were not born, in 1974, which was in the wake of the end of California's other great president, Richard Milhouse Nixon, Republicans were fired all over the country. I mean, it was you had to be, every Democrat that conceivably could have won. Only those districts where all the Democrats were in the cemetery did Republicans win. And then in 1994, the American people pronounced themselves seriously disgusted with Bill Clinton and with the way things were going, and the Democrats lost 54 seats in the House, which is astonishing. The House is much more stable than that, and it almost never happens. But I think, you know, it's interesting that it every once in a while does. This was what brought us the rule of Newt, and he, you know, it was his. He came into the Congress as Speaker, and the chairman of the Republicans had the House and Senate. And the chairman of the Democratic Party at the time, his summary of what happened was, "We got our butts kicked." I mean, that's what he said. Now, 2014 is one of those years ending in four that is 20 years after the last time this happened and 40 years after the other time it happened. So it'll be interesting to see if the 2014 campaign develops any kind of sort of momentum toward change, but that kind of electoral purge with the people actually doing it is the only really reliable change agent, it seems to me, on the relatively short term. Now, Christine Pelosi will obviously be working on that change. Sort of reminds me of Cokie Roberts. You know, when I spent a number of years covering the Congress and covering politics, and I felt that I was good at it. I felt that I understood a lot of things. And then here comes Cokie Roberts back from Rome, where her husband had been working for the New York Times. And she is, I guess back from Greece it was, and she goes to work for NPR as a temp, for all those of you who are interested in working at NPR. She comes to work as a temp, And she knows everything that I know. And she hasn't even been there for years, and she knows everything that I know. I didn't like that, I have to tell you. And I assume that Christine Pelosi is in much the same sort of shape. You know, she was raised in politics, drenched in it from the time she was a child, and she knows a lot of things that I had a hard time learning and lots of things that I haven't learned yet. She's a lawyer with a Foreign Service degree. She was a prosecutor in San Francisco. She worked in Washington, in the White House, and on the Hill. She chairs the California Democratic Party Women's Caucus. It's like there's a club in Washington, the National Democratic Women's Club, and I can never remember which words go in what order. Most notable, she's written books on campaign boot camps. This one is Boot Camp 2.0, which are immensely entertaining and very tough-minded views of how campaigns ought to go. She has developed a curriculum, a training program, which she's run for challengers all over the country. And she has carted her baby daughter along with her to these campaigns, much as she herself was carted along by her famous mother, who, in case there is anyone in this room who doesn't know it, was the Democratic leader of the House, Nancy Pelosi. Next year, her book, Women on the Run, comes out. You can find her blog on the HuffPost, and you can find her right here. Come on up. Now we have to see if these microphones that in my case are not in my pocket, because I don't have a pocket.
I don't have a pocket. Am I on?
Yes, you are. So we're both on. That's great. I'm very interested. I'm very interested in, of course, your personal history and how you learned what you do. I mean, I'm sure many of you know that Nancy Pelosi had the same sort of rearing that her daughter has had. Her father was Tommy D'Alessandro, who was the mayor of Baltimore. So that was I'm sure, an extraordinary education. She always talks about it. But I'm interested in this question of women making a difference when they get involved in politics. I think that what we're looking at in our political culture at the moment is a not very successful political culture. It could use some help. And I wonder if women can help, can make things work better. Do you think that's possible?
I do. Well, thank you, Mills. Thank you, Madam President. I love saying wonderful to be with you and your mom, and my mom being an honorary Mills grad. That makes me
and
part of the family.
Commencement speaker as well.
Yes. I would say this. I began, as Linda alluded, really in the stroller. And when we were growing up, my mom was pregnant for most of the 60s and was driving carpool for most of the 70s. We were in New York City, where my parents moved right after they got married, but they had four of us in 5 years, and then moved to California and had child number five. So between 6 years and 1 week, there were five children. So talk about coalition politics, right? Where we all were. And so for us, we grew up, our grandparents were 3,000 miles away, and that was Baltimore, Little Italy, where they were still, Big Tommy was my grandfather, Little Tommy was my uncle, both of them had been mayor, and my grandmother and was Nancy, and my mother was Little Nancy. Miss Nancy and Little Nancy. So you can see why she wanted to move 3,000 miles away. Kind of like you moving to after New Mexico. But the story that I want to tell is that, because it goes directly to your point, we grew up in San Francisco. We were raised, whatever education you can achieve, we'll find a way to help pay for it. Now, that was an easier promise to make 25 years ago than it is now. But our parents worked really hard so that we could be able to do that. And our exposure to politics was my mom being a volunteer California Democratic Party Northern Chair, and then State Chair. I'm still working now with some of the same people who elected my mom State Chair in 1982. That's how far back we go, and in grassroots politics. So it was always, can women make a difference as volunteers? It was from the standpoint of being a homemaker. Now, I graduated from Hastings Law School, passed the bar, luckily on the first try, and I got, how many lawyers are in the room?
Wow, this is a rare event.
Okay, so you know when you, the Committee on Bar Examiners sends you this beautiful invitation and it's embossed and it's this beautiful printing and it says, this is an invitation to your swearing in as a member of the California Bar, and you think, oh my God, this is great. So I called one of my girlfriends and I said, who had graduated before me, and she said, are you kidding? It's a cattle call. You're down in the Civic Center with 6,000 people. Your family can't even find you. It's like, I state your name. But, you know, it's a nice invitation. And I thought, well, I'll send it to my grandmother. Because I send every notice like that to my grandmother. She'll like it anyway. She won't come, but she'll like getting it. Impressive. So I get this note. And the note says, dear Christine, I'm the second happiest person to get your invitation to swearing in. The member of the California Bar. How happy I am to see you achieve what I could not 55 years ago. See, when before my mother was born, my grandmother had gone to night school and she wanted to be a lawyer. And then one of the kids got sick and died of whooping cough. She had another same name after her father, two more kids, and then my mom. So her dream was gone. Now my mother was seven. That my grandmother practiced law without a license and did all sorts of things, especially in Baltimore. That law army was everywhere making a difference. She was a lot tougher than my grandfather. Of course, she got in one big community fight with the power company and told them, this was when she was older, and she said, I'm on a limited income with unlimited time. So women can make it, and here I was all this time. It didn't occur to me until then I was carrying my grandmother's dream. But it made me very conscious every room I went to, because all of a sudden, I saw the power dynamic. I saw being the only woman attorney in the room, the only woman of power in the room, when I was a deputy city attorney and then a deputy prosecutor. Oh, you'd have the bailiff, in my view, the most powerful woman in the room, but you'd have the bailiff and the court reporter, but the judges would be male, the other attorneys were male, and there I'd be, carrying the flag for the sisterhood. And I found that it was different in a courtroom dynamic when there were more women judges, or even when there was another woman attorney that I was going up against. You could start to see it. Two isn't enough. With your one, you're gonna be squelched because they want you just to go along. And those of you who are women of color are climbing a double stair. Lesbians climbing a double stair. Lesbian women of color climbing the triple stair. You know what that is. You have to ascend as a professional, but you're climbing that double stair of ascending through a gender stereotype or a sexuality stereotype or a race stereotype. And I found one is not enough because they try to crush you. Two, they try to pit you against each other. So you really have to have three before people can exhale and just have a conversation. And then you can be effective. And then you just have to look out for that 1 minute mentor moment when Linda has a beautiful idea, and then two people later, Joe repeats what Linda says, not crediting Linda. And then everybody else says, didn't Joe have a great idea too? That's such a great idea. And somebody has to say, as Linda said, and go back to credit Linda, call out the 1 minute mentor. That's what happens when there are three of you. When there are two, they think, oh, it's you two ladies sticking up for each other. When there are three, you can disguise it a little bit more. It's those kinds of things where I think sisterhood is powerful if there is solidarity attached.
Mm-hmm. Well, for example, in Jean Shaheen, who's a senator from New Hampshire. Jean Shaheen, which is everybody in New Hampshire. I mean, all of the elected officials at the state level are women. I mean, all of the statewide officials are women. The Chief Justice, both senators, and all the members of the House delegation. And Jean Shaheen said, well, there are going to be six women on the Armed Services Committee. And she thinks
that's going to make a difference. This not quite, not a third members of the Senate, the 20%, they're sort of spread out in funny ways. But in some places, there are substantial numbers of them on committees.
I think it makes a difference. For example, I am very good friends with Nicole Boxer, you might recognize the last name, who is in the movies. And she worked on this film called The Invisible War. I don't know how many of you saw it, but it was nominated for an Academy Award in the documentary, and it was about military rape. And when Nicole was working in the early stages, I mean, she didn't get one of those glamorous executive producer credits where you give money and get a credit. She was actually working in the interviews with the rape survivors, the women who were service women who were raped and then expelled when they came forward. Not only were the perpetrators not charged, but the women were drummed out of the military. And they thought, well, if nothing else, this is 2 years ago, we're making movies, and well, if nothing else, we can show it to Barbara Boxer. We'll get a hearing from the women. Well, it ignited Jean Shaheen, who had had a bill forever, trying to help this problem. Suddenly, because it was critical mass on the Armed Services Committee of women, not only did the women see the film, but the men saw the film, and when Chuck Hagel was nominated for defense secretary, Jean Shaheen said, you got to see this movie, and you got to answer questions. We want to know, what are you going to do for the military women and men who've been raped? What are you going to do to solve this problem? Now, I don't think that would have happened, good as the movie was. I don't think it would have happened if you didn't have the critical mass on the critical committee of jurisdiction to really take the movie and put it right at the forefront of a confirmation, which at the time, was very controversial. So the fact that you had, among some whiny quarters, but the fact that you had women saying, we'll be for you, we would prefer Michelle Flournoy, we'll be for you, but you have to help the women.
There was a, just sort of going back in time when Hale Boggs, who was on the leadership ladder when he died in a plane crash in Alaska, when Hale Boggs died, his wife, Lindy Boggs, ran for his seat in the House. Now, as I'm sure you know from those of you who still take civics somewhere, you can't appoint somebody to the House. They have to run. So she ran. And she ran, and she said that she was not going to be the congressman from women. That was not what she was going to do. She was going to represent all of her district, which was New Orleans, and she was going to, she was going to work for all of the people in her district. And when she got to the House, one of the first things she noticed was that nobody had dealt with what she had had as a serious personal problem, which was that after her husband died, her credit went away, and she couldn't fix it, and she was, she said, I have been a customer of this bank for all these hundreds of years. Nothing has ever, I've never put a foot wrong. And what do you mean I have no credit? So she passed a law. And she said, at some point you understand that if you don't do it, nobody's going to do it. There are certain things that women have done for other women and have been able to organize on a sort of bipartisan basis for doing it, because other women understand that there's, that this is a problem that has to be solved. Now, I think that kind of, the direness of that is probably gone away, because there are so many other, so many women. There are enough women, at least, that those kinds of questions get raised. Women used to show up in the United States, in the House of Representatives, wearing black, brown, and navy blue. I mean, dressed in a, disguised as men. It was extraordinary. Nancy Pelosi is one of the first women I ever saw in beautiful colors, just saying, and she, she sort of, boing, stood out in the House of Representatives. And you think about how women were sort of submerged in that body for as long as they were. It's extraordinary.
Part of it is that well-meaning advice that they probably got from their mothers. Don't make waves, you know, you're there to make a difference, but don't get out there crusading. Now, part of that is because we're trying to protect our children, so we don't want them to, I mean, I go through this all the time with my mother. We're having a constant debate. She wants my daughter to draw color within the lines so she can get into kindergarten. I'm like, no, I don't want her to color within the lines. I want her to be an artist, so you can see where this is going to go. But it's that thing of your mom is saying, color in the lines. I want you to succeed. I don't want you to be good. I don't want them to see you as a woman. I want them to see you as a lawmaker. And that's all well and good, but sometimes you just have to be who you are. So happily, I think we've evolved out of that protective state and said, we're just going to have to break through. The women that I trained to run for Congress are so brave. They're so brave. Because they get out there, and a lot of times they're not waiting in line. They're not sitting in the chairs. When we started doing campaign boot camps with AFSCME, the Public Service Union, in 2005, we were looking to take back swing districts or Republican districts. They didn't have Democrats elected in those seats anyway. So it wasn't like you could say, let's go to the state senator or the state assembly member and put them in. That person was a Republican. They weren't a Democrat. So we found women from the business world. We found women who had served in government but not in elective office, like Kirsten Gillibrand in upstate New York who was running. We worked with people who had not come from politics. And part of my job was to sort of be a code talker and explain the things that are in my DNA to people who were not political at all other than having voted, but they had been civic advocates. And again, what we found was that women who had made it, for example, as lawyers, women who had made it in journalism, women who had already pushed through in another man's world, could translate that struggle more adeptly into politics, and they ended up being quite successful.
One of my personal hates is the woman who says, you know, I don't know what they're talking about impediments placed in their path. That has never happened to me. You know, and I'm just thinking, well, you want to step outside and I'll put some impediments. But it is so incredibly, it seems like they're on another planet somehow. Now, I do want to, I love this little box. This is in Bootcamp 2.0. Tips for women candidates confronting stereotypes. This calls for call and response. If you are what they'll say about you. So single.
Can't attract somebody.
Married.
You should be, put your husband or your spouse over your career.
Got kids?
Who's taking care of the children? They're in college, who's taking care of them?
Divorced.
Couldn't keep them.
Widowed?
You killed him. Now, let me speak a couple stories about that. That would come up over and over and over again. I met my husband the week before I turned 40, so I was a very late bloomer. So for a very long time, I got the, why aren't you married? Where's your boyfriend? The, oh, I suppose you just want your career and not a man. I'm like, well, no, I'm trying. And then I got married, and all of a sudden, and then I got pregnant rather quickly. So when I was going on the trail, I was getting bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger in the election of 08. And it was, oh, you're going to stay home once the baby's born. And they met Bella. Well, she's been going around with me since she was 4 months old. And that's always my first question, who's going to take care of her? I get childcare first, and then I make the speech or make the arrangement. But it's a constant thing. And I'll tell you this thing, that line at the end that's kind of funny and kind of not funny. There were two Democrats running for Congress who had deceased spouses. The woman, Lois Capps from California, her husband, Walter Capps, was an amazing, amazing professor down Santa Barbara. Just an amazing, amazing, wonderful person. And he was in Congress and he died. And Lois, a nurse and a healthcare advocate in her own right, ran for the seat and was very much embraced. And people said, well, you can do this and hold the seat, but you don't really need to stay. Then her daughter got sick a couple terms in and died, and people said, it's okay, you can go home now. You can go home now, you've proved your point. Peter Welch, running in Vermont, few years later, just a couple cycles ago, his wife died. Oh, the casserole Katie showed up at his home and at the headquarters. How can we help? Let's embrace this campaign. You have to run to keep this. It's what your wife would have wanted. Now, these are two sets of Democrats. I'm not even talking about the other, about my own party. These are two liberal, they wouldn't mind me saying that, progressive Democrats. But yet, to protect them, because they love them, their own supporters were reinforcing these gender stereotypes. So I think that if you're a woman candidate who's running, if you're advising a woman who's running, you have to wear it lightly. You have to understand that everybody's going to talk. That they're going to ask as if it's their business in a way that they would never ask a man, and you can't tell them that they're not asking the man that question. They'll come over and pat your belly. What did they do? Everybody's a big expert on pregnancy anyway, especially when you're up there, as I was, running for Democratic National Committee, and everybody had a theory. And in fact, I got more advice on my pregnancy than I did on my campaign. So, but I'll tell you what happened when I was a younger attorney. I had just gotten this big civic award in San Francisco. And I was a deputy city attorney here. I was this prosecutor. I had sold all these tables to judges and colleagues, some of whom were also getting awards. Like 8 of us got honored. I was one of them. So I was really excited because I had, you know, been my mother's daughter around the courthouse. All of a sudden, here I was getting this civic award in my own right. So I get up there. And 2 of my sisters were already married, my other sister and my brother were not, and I was not. So coming up to us was Mama Tina, our great, great, dear friend. She comes up and she says, full voice, Christine, I'm so proud of you. I'm praying for your husband. And I'm crushed because I think, oh, I'm finally not my mother's daughter. Now she thinks I'm Nancy or she thinks I'm Jacqueline, one of my sisters. And I say, no, Tina, it's Christine. I don't have a husband. She says, I know, that's why I'm praying for him. And all I could do was laugh, because what am I gonna do? My colleagues roared for years, and they said, pray for your husband, where's that husband? She's gotta pray harder. So yeah, and then at the memorial service, my brother got up and told that story, and they all roared. Because they all knew, here she's trying to help me. But at the same time,
reinforcing.
Reinforcing.
Yeah.
Out of love. These are your friends.
Well, now, in this book, you know, this reminded me, the boot camp is of the sort of politics in beanbag school of educating. Now, this is really something that only a few people... Finley Peter Dunn, who was an essayist at the turn of the last century, he created a character called Mr. Dooley. And Mr. Dooley was the one who said, politics ain't beanbag. Politics is a heavy-duty contact sport. It's very tough to get into. And you spend a lot of time trying to say, you gotta be tough.
The very first time I blogged was April 11th, 2006. And I had set up a blog for Francine Busby, who was running a special election. I went down to blog the special election in San Diego, where Duke Cunningham was soon to join the federal correction system. And the very first blog post that I did...
As a tenant.
Yes, as a tenant. And the very first post, about the third or fourth comment, was a nasty gram from a sexual predator I had prosecuted years before as a deputy DA. And he had sued the city and tried to sue me because I wanted to collect his DNA because he was a child rapist, so I thought we should have his DNA on record in the event that there were other victims out there of his. And so that was my first experience with blogging. Welcome to politics 2.0. That was That was my welcome. The good news was that other people on the comment section, now I had posted and then I went out and walked precincts, so I got back and looked at the box and I was like, oh my God, this is, and it makes you want to shut it down and say, well, I'm not gonna do blogging anymore, but you can't. You have to keep going. When I was on television promoting Barack Obama, the number of people, the rumors, because I'd worked on Capitol Hill, they said I had an affair with my boss and I had two abortions. This is like kind of 4-year period, supposedly. I must have been very busy. you know, just the stuff that people would come up with, and then they'd call, you know, then real reporters would call my former boss for comment. Like, that's how nasty they want to make it, because they were trying to say to me, it ain't beanbag, here's your opening pitch. We're going to come after you and make it so ugly, you're not going to want to do it. Now, all of you probably saw a little bit about what happened to my mother, who went from being this nice, pretty, actually, personally conservative Italian grandmother to being Attila the Honey. and even now, when I deal with candidates, our donors are very clear. They love Nancy Pelosi. They don't want to write a check to an organization that's going to hire a staffer that's going to tell the candidate, run away from Nancy Pelosi. They know everyone has to run their own race, but they don't want to see, they don't want to write a check and have it end up paying the salary of somebody who says, well, we don't want Nancy Pelosi to come in this district, or we don't want to campaign with her, we want to take your money, but we don't want to be seen with you. You know, I know that people, and I'll just call candidates and say, look, you're being swift-voted about my mother. Let's just talk about what your strategy is going to be. And at first they're like, oh my God, because they think I'm going to be mad at them or something. Mm-hmm. No, we just need a strategy, and we just need to know what it is. Because our donors have, this is how they feel, our supporters, this is how they feel. So if you're going to come out to San Francisco, that's not going to work, because like we're going to be here, right? So that's not going to be a good strategy. You want to run your own race, run your own race, but you have to run your own race with your own support. And you work it out, you figure it out, but you have to be tough about that. I always tell my husband, don't read the comments on my posts. I'll send you what I wrote. Don't do that. When I was announced in the news that I was pregnant, people told me, literally, I was blogging about something else on Huffington, and they were writing in things like, you're a liberal, why don't you just abort? Welcome to the world. So that's the way it is. But I also know that it has to be really, really tough. So here's what I did the last time I was on Fox television, and a woman had said, oh my God, Botox alert. The nut doesn't fall far from the tree.
Oh, great.
So I wrote back, dear whoever, dear her name, and I said, as a mother of a toddler, I haven't had a good night's sleep in 3 years, so I take your Botox remark as a compliment.
But in addition, though, to the, you know, just sort of all of these preparation for being whatever you need to be in order to survive in this world, you also have some very idealistic ideas about what candidates should do. And chief among them is understand why it is that you want to serve. What is it? What is your service? How do you feel about it? How can you identify it? I mean, I think that is idealistic, and it's like, you know, I can imagine that people who are working through campaigns are sort of pulled in all kinds of directions, but that is one of the most interesting things you said, I thought.
Thank you. I think that having worked in a lot of campaigns, and sometimes I was wondering what the person was doing, when I grew up growing up in politics, you see a lot of people who want to be something or want to do something. The workhorses and the show horses identify themselves relatively quickly among the candidates and among the hangers-on. And so I think it's very important to understand somebody's motivation, because they're never more passionate than when they want your vote. So if someone isn't going to tell you what he or she believes when she's asking for your vote, then chances are they're not going to tell you when you're asking for their vote in a legislature. So it's incredibly important to understand your call to service and not run for something that you don't really believe in, because you're just going to be phoning it in because it's a stepping stone. And it's important, I think, for young people to find the passion. Consider the thing, you know, what are you best at? What do you major in? You probably got better grades in things that you like than classes that you were sort of forced to take because Mills College made you do that. Make you well-rounded, right? But, you know, think about it. If you look at the application essays that you wrote to get into high school, to get into college, to apply for a job, any personal statement that any of you had to make, in the seeds of that is probably your call to service. I say that, as the baseball players would say, that's your wheelhouse. Stick with that. If at all possible, not confine your public service, but define your public service based on that, because that's your true authentic self. And on the really, really bad days when they're telling you that you're being, you know, stalked by some guy who used to prosecute, or they're telling you you should have aborted your child, you know what? Your call to service is what keeps you going. And it makes sure that you don't ride the highs too high, because it's not about you, and that you don't internalize the lows too low, because it's not about you. But if you ask someone why they're running for office and they can't tell you, do not waste your time.
Okay. Well, now this is your time. You can ask either one of us questions or talk about whatever. I mean, I always hate it when I'm up here making speeches and somebody else gets up and makes a speech. However, I mean, I'm prepared to be tolerant, I guess. But the what about questions?
There are microphones on either side of the main aisle right here. If you come and use the microphone.
Do you see the... There's one. There's one.
So we can get them recorded?
So that you can... Well, that's a good idea. Okay. Number one. It's always hard to be number one, but one of the things that you have to learn at Mills is you have to be number one.
I'm wondering if you could talk a little bit about what's happening with Elizabeth Warren. We don't see anything about her in the news.
Elizabeth Warren, in the senator from Massachusetts we're talking?
Yes.
As far as I know, Elizabeth Warren, I mean, I don't know that there is anything happening with Elizabeth Warren. Do you?
Oh, there's a beautiful moment. Go home and Google it. It's on YouTube.
Really?
Elizabeth Warren made it very clear that she wanted to be on the banking committee. The banking community made it very clear they did not want her to be there. However, she was appointed, and the bank executive just showed up. This is about 8 days, maybe 10 days ago. It was right in the middle of the VAWA fight, so it was kind of easy to miss because we were all...
Women Against Violence Act.
Women's Act, right. And
Violence Against Women Act.
She took on these executives so hard. It was exactly what you thought was going to happen when she got elected. And she said, so basically what you're saying is too big to fail is too big to sue. And that was the tagline. And it was, people were sending it around like wildfire, saying like, this is what we sent her there to do. This is why she's in there fighting. So she had a great, quiet, head down start. Hillary Clinton before her, you know, she took her time at the microphone. And normally those hearings are disaster, because as Linda was saying earlier, someone gets up and uses their 5 minutes, and then the next person asks something that's completely unrelated, or they ask the same question. It's like they didn't coordinate their questioning at all. But she was very clear, she had a purpose, very methodical, very short amount of time, but boom. So she's doing great.
Okay, over here, yes?
Hi, so Ms. Wertheimer, when you mentioned the Vatican conclave being the only event left where no women are present, I was wondering what you thought on the women priests and how they're starting their own hierarchy. There are women ordained as priests in the Catholic Church, although the Vatican doesn't recognize them. And then there are bishops, and I don't know if there's anything higher than that, but I wonder what your thoughts are as they kind of start their own mirrored hierarchy to the Catholic Church.
Well, you know, if you take the long view of the Church, which I guess there really isn't any other way, any other view, if you take the long view of the Church, they're running out of priests. Now, a lot of people think that the obvious solution is to change the rules of celibacy so that other people who have married or, you know, you can draw on a larger community of people to be priests. But another possibility, of course, is the ordination of women. But we haven't gotten, as far as I know, much past the sort of lower ranks in the deaconate is not even, I think, entirely open to women yet in the Catholic Church, although it is in almost everything else. So I think that time may bring this about, but I think it's, you know, longer than I'm going to live. What do you think?
I think it's a very, very long time. Unfortunately, technically speaking, the cardinals do not have to elect a cardinal, so they could put a nun as pope. I mean, legally.
They could do it. That's true.
That is true. I mean, I remember that much from Catholicism. However, more likely, and President and I were talking about this earlier, it's unlikely that we're going to have a reformer in this bunch unless there's a secretly a David Souter out there, right, who has not made his intentions known to his fellow cardinals. Wouldn't that be wonderful if that person were pope at this time? It is really the future, because two things really happen. First of all, the sexual assault cases, and I say this as someone who arraigned Catholic priests in San Francisco in the late 90s, which is a weird thing to have the priest come in and be arraigned for sexual assault, and have really powerful lawyers giving their time pro bono, so they said, to defending said person. But they really bankrupted a lot of dioceses with payments to sexual assault victims.
Right.
So number one. Number two, not only are they running out of priests, they're in the US and Europe, where they're not running out of priests, but they're still too racist to fully embrace them, is the third world. So that would be the other question. Could we get an African pope? Could we get a Latin American pope? And would that perhaps open us up to a younger and a more, shall we say, accessible clergy? That I think it's possible that you would see exemptions to the priesthood. In other words, a divorced person could become a priest. I think it'd be more likely you would see that and a higher role for women than I don't know that I would see ordination in my lifetime now.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's such an interesting quandary for the church, and I think there's even controversy in the Catholic Church, in the modern Catholic Church, about women saints. Mm-hmm. I mean, to talk about going into politics, going into sainthood is also not easy.
The last precinct.
Yeah. But it's fascinating. It's fascinating to watch. And as I say, I think this is one of the great political events that ever happens. Yes.
Ms. Pelosi, you mentioned that a lot of the reinforcement of gender stereotypes is what hinders women, even if it is well meant. I know that a lot of that starts at a very, very young age, sometimes at infancy, with picking out colors and different ways of complimenting children. So how would you suggest that we, I don't want to say combat it, but amend it? Amend the loving, well-intentioned help from friends and family that ends up hindering women in politics?
Well, one of the things that cracks up my closest friends probably the most about my own motherhood is that the shower invitation said no pink, and my daughter is a princess. So they're like, this is karma, just coming. She's already worn more dresses, worn more makeup, and certainly more tutus than I have in my entire life, and she's not even four. So I try to see it as a phase. But see, my strategy was to occupy the princess, I would say. Princesses are nice to their mommies. No, they don't. They really don't want to have mommies. Well, that's true. You go to the storyline. Well, Tiana does. Okay, so that's one, right? Going through and saying, first of all, acknowledging that some things are going to be phases, and try to mix it up as much as possible. Compliment her on her smarts and not just her looks. Hey, sweet girl, and hey, pretty girl, two different things. Sweet, smart, adjectives that go to what we call in our household beauty on the outside, as opposed to just beauty in outside words and outside reflections and not just the physicality of it. But I think I get to say I fought a losing battle against the princess until I decided to occupy it. And I think that when you say to friends and family, look, give her what she wants. She's going to get a multitude of things. But don't tell her that she's pretty. If she does something good, tell her she's smart, or that she's clever, or that she's kind. But try to find a way to compliment her, and please compliment her. But compliment her on something that's going to help her out in the long term. Because if girls are sexualized at a very, very early age, told at a very, very early age, pretty little girls know that they're getting something that less pretty girls are not getting. Look at what just happened at the Oscars. right? Here you have a 9-year-old best actress nominee, sexualized by the host and vulgarized by the onion in a way that no other 9-year-old white girls were. So not only did we have a problem of sexism, we had a problem of racism, and unfortunately, it took some prominent white feminists a long time to understand that there was some racism going on there. They didn't quite see the need for that solidarity. So I would say, to the extent possible, that we can promote solidarity, that you can promote, she's going to be watching cartoons. Better that she's watching Doc McStuffins than yet another episode of, The Ponies. So again, let's try to find the positive role models at a younger age, and also the cartoons, the cartoon characters of color or from different racial backgrounds, to let them see that ideations of beauty are not just physical, and even when they are physical, they're not just white.
Is there a way to do that on a larger scale than just family, though? Is there a way to do this that isn't just, within your own family or within your own friend group, like society as a whole, or maybe through like the education system even? I have no idea.
The Women's Media Center has some pretty good resources on this because they start very young. That's one. Jennifer Siegel Newsom has done a show called Misrepresentation, and they have a curriculum that they actually have in hundreds of schools, where they're talking about the representation of girls, and they have exercises that are part of the curriculum. So I would say, look to the Women's Media Center. They've got a lot of good resources. Look to misrepresentation, two S's in the misrepresentation, for some ideas. But there are people trying to change that dynamic in the classroom, in the media, and organizing what they call not buying it, boycotts, girlcotts, and education campaigns, so that we have to change the bottom line. In other words, there has to be a push in the financial bottom line in order to make a change in the product that we see. And
thank
also,
you.
Jamie Lee Curtis is a very strong advocate. So you should look at some of the books that she's written for children. She's very strong on that as well. But I think if you look at those two organizations in particular, you'll find some ideas.
Over here.
Thank you.
Hi. Thank you for coming to Mills and for spending time with us. I have two questions. One, in one of my public policy courses, we discussed the fact that Barack Obama had a much broader impact in social media using Facebook and Twitter in the 2008 elections, in contrast to Hillary Clinton, which didn't make it far in the elections. And I would like to know if you have a comment regarding social media and the way that it impacted Hillary Clinton's campaign in 2008. And my other question is pretty obvious. What do you think of Hillary in 2016 or any other women candidate in the upcoming elections?
But you mean Hillary for president? Is that what you're talking about?
Yes.
Okay.
I hope so.
You know far more about social media than I do.
In 2007, when Barack Obama was 30 points behind Hillary Clinton, there were only a certain number of things that he could do. And one of them was to go out and find an organization and grow it from the bottom up. I was in South Carolina the night before the primary in January 2008, and I was doing my boot camp, and I talked about the house meetings that the farm workers did, and that people have been doing for 50 years, organizing people one house meeting at a time. And I did this boot camp for people from all the campaigns, Richardson, Edwards, Clinton, Obama, and observers who were just there, there to check out the gestalt of a presidential campaign. And so a Hillary person raised her hand, it's more the Hillary button on, raised her hand and said, "We don't do those in South Carolina." And a Barack Obama person raised his hand and said, "We did." And turned to the Clinton person and said, "You had all the top-down people. You had all the ministers, you had all the elected officials. Edwards had a couple, Clinton had the rest. Obama didn't have any of those people. They had to use social media. They had to use old-fashioned house meetings as well as new media technologies to catch up, because that was the only way that they were going to catch fire with people. What they did is they decided that the way they were going to grow that campaign was to build an online community. I will say, some of those same tools were offered to Hillary Clinton's campaign. in some cases by some of the very same consultants who ended up switching to Barack Obama, because it was like, remember, a 30-point difference. Do you want to win with Hillary, or do you want to lose with Obama?
In some new and interesting way with
right.
Obama.
What's your choice? And unfortunately for Hillary Clinton, her very top-down campaign, people, they didn't get it. They didn't understand it until it was too late. They didn't understand the power of doing it. And I knew that they were going to lose Iowa when they were complaining that when it came to the Iowa caucuses, they were deriding the social media strategy that Barack Obama had among college students, because they said, what they're going to do is bus in people from Illinois to Iowa, and they're going to campaign, they're going to caucus in Iowa as college students, then they're going to go home to Illinois and vote there in a couple of weeks. And I never think that it's good for one campaign to accuse another campaign of potential voter fraud, especially when both campaigns are Democratic, and especially when the campaign you're accusing is an African-American presidential campaign. It was so bad, and the backlash was so bad, and the backlash spread through social media. So when Bill Clinton and David Yepsen, who you know, right,
mm-hmm,
the dean
right.
of the Iowa reporters,
political
saying,
reporters,
oh, cluck, 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 these kids are going to pack the caucuses, isn't this terrible? Now, some of you are college students. If the former president of the United States dared you to come off your Christmas vacation and come back and prove him wrong by showing up to caucus, would you do that or stay home? They came back in big numbers. And the Clinton campaign figured it out about a week out, and they said, oh my God, they saw the backlash happening, and they saw it on social media. And so then they had Chelsea put something out there that said, bring somebody with you to caucus to the, you know, bring a friend to the caucus and all this, and they sort of made up a little lost ground with Chelsea. But I think that if they had used Chelsea a month earlier, when the Obama campaign was really doing this youth movement, and if they hadn't feared what was happening on social media so much, but instead saw this as an opportunity to engage people, I think that the race might have been very different. But in that case, as one person who ended up being for Obama, and actually is now serving the administration, I saw him at an Obama event, and I said, do the Clintons know you're here? And he said, yeah, well, I had a choice between IBM and the startup, and I went for the startup. And the startup beat IBM. It was, and I think that Hillary has learned an awful lot from that campaign. And in social media, the State Department really has harnessed the power of social media. She's talked about digital freedom all over the world. I think that if Hillary wants to run, she's got my superdelegate vote. A lot of us are waiting for Hillary. She's our first choice. I think she pretty much clears the field on the Democratic side. And part of it is because she did an amazing job as Secretary of State. Part of it, too, is those texts from Hillary are not the funniest ones, right? She got social media. When she responded to them, like, you knew. She got it. She's now fully Hillary 2.0, and I think the sky's the limit for her.
Do you think that it's possible that there'll be some sort of technological shift again by 2016 so that social media will change, or the existence of social media will change?
Absolutely. It's changing now. People are already leaving Facebook. I mean, we did this thing where we were trying to bridge the digital divide when I worked in the Clinton administration and get everybody on a laptop. Then everybody got to a smartphone, so forget the laptops, right? Now we're doing Wi-Fi. Forget wiring homes. Mm-hmm. Now we want universal Wi-Fi. So the technology changed. People are already off Facebook. They did a report out today on how Zuckerberg has to figure out how to channel his inner child, because people are leaving Facebook in droves because they just want to, they live on YouTube. My stepson's 13. He lives on YouTube, not Facebook. People are going to continue to find a way that's going to be A, a little bit subversive, B, someone was asking me about this earlier, where they won't be data mined, and can too. Remember, there's always something new that's happening. But people will always want to express themselves, and they will always feel, I believe, in social media, a little small L libertarian streak that runs through Democrats, Republicans, you know, across the spectrum, where people say, I don't want you to take me for granted. I don't want you to think that you know me. because you know the magazine I subscribe to, you know that I'm a lawyer, you know certain things about me. I don't want you to presume how I'm going to vote or how I'm going to feel. And if you prepackage something to me on social media, I'm going to have a really strong backlash against that. They don't like blanket rules. They don't like data mining. And so I think that there will be new social media ways of communicating, but what will never change is that desire for self-expression and for authenticity.
And the idea, of course, I assume that political campaigns will have figured out that they have to stay abreast of all of this stuff, and they have to be, you know, they have to be ready, they have to be responsive, and they have to understand. And it's, it happens so quickly. It's real. I'm very impressed with how amazing it is. I will say that I agree that Hillary Clinton's got the Democratic nomination if she wants it. And the big question is, does she want it? And when you start thinking about, okay, who will the Republicans run? Anybody got any ideas?
Jeb Bush,
Paul Ryan, you know, these are, but you can like make up the campaign in your head already. It's gonna be a tough campaign for the Republicans. Yes?
Hi, my name is Patricia Black. Sorry, I'm a little bit taller than everyone else that's been talking. Can you hear me on it? Is it okay?
Yeah.
My name is Patricia Black, and I'm a student in the Public Policy Department here at Mills. About a year ago, I was in class, and one of my professors asked the class, who here is interested in running for public office? There were only two of us who raised our hands in a class of about 40. My question is, how do we get more women, young, intelligent, passionate women, to be interested in running for office?
Well, first we have to crack the code. In other words, explain it to you. That's why we do the boot camps. That's why I do so much training around the country to say, you know this. Because what women will do is take a look at the qualifications for a job and say, well, if I don't have all of them, I better not try. Versus a man will have some of them and say, well, okay. Go give it a shot. Try this out and see. And I think some of getting rid of some of that self-doubt, promoting education, but there are three things that women have to offer. One is time, and time is at a premium. So we need to encourage family-friendly workplace environments where women can thrive to a management level. I think that's why there was such a backlash against what Yahoo did in making a blanket telework ban, which I think they'll walk back from relatively quickly into something more customized. But women have to have a credential in order to run. So what we need to make sure is that we are accrediting women and giving them the opportunity to be managers, to be at that higher level where they can translate that skill in public policy. So that's one, that's time. The second one is, there's some polling that the Barberly, not our Barberly, but the Massachusetts Barberly Family Foundation did that I think that you all might find interesting. They just did it on coming off the campaign trail, Democrats, Republicans, it was bipartisan polling, and it was about what makes an effective woman leader. And they said that both men and women had to be likable and qualified. Stop me if you've heard this before. For a man, he could be unlikable and still qualified. For a woman, they now have quantitative proof that if people think you are not likable, they also think that you're not qualified. And so, case in point, San Diego, California. Two Democrats running at the exact same time in the exact same primary race in June. One of them was Bob Filmer running in the very crowded primary for mayor. And everybody said, oh my God, Bob has been mean and nasty to everybody. 20 years he's been in Congress. We're going to go elect him mayor. That's how he is. He's just tough, but he's Bob, and he gets things done, and that's just how he's a little army, but it's okay. And there's a woman running for Congress against the fellow who won the primary and ultimately the general election. And they said, oh, Saldana, yeah, she's good, but she carries a lot of grudges. She burns a lot of bridges. She's not nearly as bad as Bob. Still, I don't know. I don't know that she's very good. How could she do the job if she can't really bring people together? And she got marked down. The same voters. And one was going to be here, and one was going to be 3,000 miles away. So it wasn't like, well, I don't want to run into both of them at City Hall every day. I mean, it wasn't that. It was, they did not feel that she was as qualified because they did not feel that she was as likable. So we have to help women get experience in positions of power where they're dealing with money, where they're dealing with security, and where they're dealing with values. Because what are they going to say? Can you handle my money? Can you keep me safe? And can you project strong values? And so women have to have the opportunity to be able to learn in a tough cauldron how to be a likable person. I know it sounds ridiculous and it's demeaning, but those are the stereotypes we have to overcome. And third, money. We have to do more in campaign finance reform. In places where you have more of that or cheaper elections, it's a lot easier for women to assert themselves and get elected. And progressives, feminists, that come out and do that, because corporations are always going to be able to write a check. We know that. But individuals are less likely to write big checks. So that's why women have to harness the power of social media, and women candidates and non-corporate candidates have to be able to have those long-time networks of friends and family to back them up. Because again, we'll all end where we started with the if you're single, you can't attract him, and you're divorced, you couldn't keep him, and all that. People are still going to say, I want to see a woman succeed, but I also don't want to feel like she is the B word. I don't want to vote for a B word. And so that's why she needs a sisterhood of people around her, because when people see women candidates with other women, that's why Ignite, which was started here by Ann Moses, one of your professors, why Emerge, where some of your graduates have also graduated, why Emily's List and Susan B. Anthony List on the Republican side, why you have women training programs trying to help women network together so that they can overcome that resistance and have the solidarity of their peers when they decide to put themselves out there. Those are the things that we need.
The very thing that that you're talking about is one of the reasons why so many women who are in the House, for example, to get that qualification to move up, are widows. You know, they get a chance without having to demonstrate a lot of other stuff. And then when they get the job, then they can prove themselves in the job. But it's an awful thought to think that, you know, if you really wanted to get your start in politics, what you needed to do was not have a husband anymore. That would not be a good thing. But it is remarkable the numbers of people whose political careers have been made possible by the loss of a spouse, because there's so many other odd little ways in which people judge women, and that is not, and that one women get through.
I think that's right. I think that it's also changing now.
Of course,
for women, because slowly moving a ship. I mean, it very slowly. But what does happen every now and again? We go back to the question about Elizabeth Warren. Very smart, academic, did not come from politics, didn't think she was going to be in politics, had written an article about a consumer agency that she thought would be a good idea, didn't get confirmed. Boy, they're probably wishing they confirmed her now. she's going to have a lot more power as a senator than she would have as a head of an agency, being at their beck and call. So I think that, again, we're looking for women in non-political traditions to come out and step forward and say, this is something I can do. And also, you don't have to do it for a whole career. In other words, you don't have to get in and say, I'm going to start running for office when I'm 25 and I have to do this for 50 years. You can come in mid-level, which they tried to do with the 2012 project this year. Another great California woman, Mary Hughes, co-founded that, where in a bipartisan way, they tried to get women at the mid-career level to come run in their 40s and 50s. But I think the key is for people to understand that there's not a great mystery to politics. They're not things that they're discussing in Congress that you're not discussing in your world. They just have more facts in front of them because they have, you know, $1 million budget of staffers who can brief them on those issues. But this is stuff that you know. And I think that so often politics tries to mystify it or talk in an alphabet soup or in a way that is very closed off to people to somehow control the conversation. And I think that technology is just completely breaking down that conversation and breaking down those barriers. What we're seeing with the Tea Party, for example, is people are saying you don't have to be in politics to run against politics, to go in and stop government. All you have to do is hate government more than the other guy in the primary, or the gal in the primary. In a way, it's sort of healthy for democracy that you have probably more non-career Republicans in Congress than you've ever had before, non-career politician Republicans than before. It's making it tough for Mr. Boehner.
Mr. Boehner.
Pressure. However,
his move to tears frequently by the.
imagine, right? If just in the middle of a speech there was a blubbering up that just happened on a regular basis for her.
And what would people say? What would say about her if? You know, I think that there is a. I take your point that technology is busting down a lot of those kinds of concerns. But one of the sort of home truths of politics is that if the entry point is a primary in a midterm election, I mean that's what the Tea Party did. The Tea Party went into midterm election primaries, where nobody votes. You know, 17 or 18 people vote. So one of the things you have to remember in this, you know, in this interesting political world we're in now, is voting. You think of all of the people that got elected to the school board in states across the country who have very extraordinary ideas about education. Because nobody votes in those elections.
Low-hanging fruit, people say. It's 8,000 votes.
Yes.
You could be deciding creationism taught to a school district full of kids.
Yeah, or to a state in some cases, yeah.
So I actually want to tee up one thing that you had said in your remarks. I thought it was very important. I do some work with Univision, and they are doing a lot of work. That company is doing a lot of work to encourage candidates on both sides of the aisle to really reach out to people using Spanish language media, meaning not just Univision, they don't have a multiplicity of a monopoly of stations, so sometimes it's Telemundo, it's radio, it's the internet, really doing Spanish language outreach. As someone who's passionate and active on the gun violence prevention issue, I cannot tell you how difficult it has been and how surprisingly, disappointingly difficult it has been for me to get some of the groups that you've all read about and that you've been reporting about to even do a Spanish language page. I mean, how hard is it to put the San Diego Promise in Spanish? How hard is it to have a contact Congress message in Spanish on the Bloomberg Super PAC website, right? Mm-hmm. He's got the money, right? He even has a fake Twitter account at Lumbito who criticizes him for learning Spanish. Somebody can figure out how to do that two-line message in Spanish, but they're not doing it. So it's not that people aren't voting because they say, well, I haven't decided between the two. They're not voting because nobody's asking. People aren't giving them the respect. And as going back to the Boggs family, there was an old story that came out of Louisiana. This is where I first heard the saying that was a call issued from a preacher in the African American community. If you don't respect us, don't expect us.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Well, it is with great regret that I see people standing to ask questions, and I'm hoping that Linda and Christine will stick around a little bit to answer those questions. But we're past our time, and as I promised you, this was going to be a fascinating conversation with two extraordinary women, and I would ask you to join me in thanking them for their participation today.